You want to pray and commit yourself to the hands of God this very afternoon. That as we want to go into the Word of God, as the choir sang to us, love will be our home. The Lord will fulfill this in your own home, in your life, in your family. That the Word of God you are going to hear today will minister life to you. And great things the Lord will do in your home in Jesus' name. Commit yourself to the hands of God. Talk to the Lord. Ask that the Lord himself will speak his word to your heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father and our God, we want to thank you for the ministration. And for the way you've been blessing us since we came here. Thank you, Lord, for the time of the searching the scriptures. Thank you for all our singings. Thank you, Lord, for our prayer time. Thank you, Lord, for everything you've done in our lives. And Lord, as we come to the clamors of our Sunday service today, knowing that today is a special day, even in our church here, I pray that, Lord, you will minister your word to every one of our hearts in Jesus' name. I pray that this word of God, Father, will be real in every life, will be real in every heart, will be real in every family, will be real even in our church in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray as you show us the roadmap today, to where you want our families to be, to where you want your church to be in this new year and all through our lives here on earth. I pray that the grace to take these things in and begin to practicalize them and begin to demonstrate them and begin to pattern our lives in accordance to this roadmap that you are showing to your church today. I pray, O God, that you give us the grace that will be the doers of these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Father, because I know you've had an answer. Worship and we exalt your name, Lord. Every spirit of buying and selling that want to steal the word of God away from the heart of the people today, I bind them by the authority of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. I pray that this word of God, we are not going to hear and forget, but we are going to hear and it will abide and we will do in accordance to your word in Jesus' name. And the benefit of the doers of your word, Lord, you will derive from your word today in Jesus' name. Spirit of the living God, I pray you take over these clear lips of mine and use to bless your people today in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, because I know you've had an answer. Inspire your word, O God, into every heart here today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you, God bless you. Can we be seated, please? As you know, today is a special day in our church here, deeper than every church I believe. And I can see, you know, all our smiling faces, we are all expectant. And before we go into the dinner we are going to have today, we just want to talk, you know, just in line with what we study from our search the scriptures. And also in line with what we are doing today. Today in our Sunday message, we are considering the message titled, The Vision 2020 Roadmap for a divinely impacted family. The Vision 2020 roadmap for a divinely impacted family. We are looking at the roadmap that God has set for us in His Word. If our family is going to be impacted by the Lord Himself, the design, the original design, what God wants our family to be. Like you know, this year is the year of divine impartation. Like our Father in the Lord told us, we have a vision 2020. And as He explained to us, if you open your Bible with me to 2 Chronicles, let's go back again to that vision 2020. and the roadmap that the Lord has set for our families. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, I'll read verse 20. It says there, "And they rose up early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Topher. And as they went forth," now let me just stop there. You see these people here, the children of Israel, they woke up. They have something to do. They have a responsibility. The prophecy has come from the prophet, and that prophecy has been given to them, that this is the roadmap, that this is what is expected of them to do. And the children of Israel, that we read in this verse 20, they were not negligent about it. They were not hazarded about it. They were not delaying about it. They rose up early. They were diligent to ensure that that roadmap, that thing that had been given to them, they followed it and they lived in accordance to the thing. The same thing the Lord is telling us today, that as we share, as the Lord share with us the roadmap, the design, the pattern, the principles that the Lord wants our families and our homes to be built upon. You don't delay. You don't say, "Oh, I will think about it." You don't say, "Oh, I will do it another day." You don't say, "Oh, I will push it aside and look for a convenient time when I will be able to particularize this word of God." No, not at all. But like the children of Israel, we want to wake up early. We want to be diligent. We want to take it upon ourselves that the thing we are going to share with you, the thing the Lord Himself is going to reveal to us in His Word, that you are going to particularize them, that you are going to pattern your life, that you are going to pattern your conduct, that you are going to pattern your family, that you are going to pattern your own act in accordance to the word that the Lord is giving to us. That's why He says here that they rose up early. And what did they do? And they went forth. They went forth. You will go forth. This year, you will make progress. I said, this year, you will make progress. Husband and wife, you will make progress. As a man, you will make progress. As a woman, you will make progress. As youth in the family, children in the family, you will make progress. You want to go forward this year, and you are not going backward in Jesus' name. Jehoshaphat then stood. Jehoshaphat stood and said, "Hear me, O Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God." Believe, believe, believe in the Lord your God. Believe that all these things we are going to read together today, it's coming from the Lord. It's not coming from the pastor. It's not the idea of the society we follow. It's not the pattern of the celebrities out there we follow. It's the pattern in accordance to the word of God. Believe, and we are going to believe. Tell your neighbor, "I'll be a believer." Talk to your neighbor. Tell him with confidence that you are going to be a believer. And you are going to do this thing. He says, "Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established." Believe his prophet, so shall ye prosper. We will prosper this year in Jesus' name. That's the vision 2020. But what's the roadmap? We'll go back again to our text. For a divinely imparted family. Colossians chapter 3. Open your Bible with me to Colossians chapter 3. We'll read from verse 18. Colossians chapter 3, we'll be taking our main text from. "Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well pleasing unto the Lord. Father, forsake not your own children to anger, provoke not your own children to anger, lest they be discouraged. From this passage of scriptures where we were, you will see the roadmap that the Lord has designed for every family, for every marriage, for every life, so that we can enjoy the benefits that can be derived from such marriages and from such homes. In our text, you see there that the wife is to submit to her own husband, not to any other man. There are some wives, they can submit to the pastors, they can submit to their managers in the office, but when they come back home, no submission to the wife, no submission to their own husband, no respect and honor to their own husband. But the Bible says, as a wife, as the woman in that home, your first point of submission is your husband. That's your first point of submission that the Lord recognizes in His word. Wives, submit unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. What is that telling us? As it is in accordance to the word of God. There are some wives that married unbelieving husbands, and that does not cancel that marriage. You know, people tell us today that, oh, now that maybe you got married before you became converted, and now you are converted, but your own husband is still an unbeliever. He's not yet a Christian. Does that mean that you need to pack out of the house and say, well, since I'm a Christian now, and I cannot marry this man? No, not at all. As long as that marriage is recognized by God and by the society, that marriage is recognized by God. And as a result of that, the Bible says you are to submit unto your own husband as it is fit in the Lord. What does that imply? If your husband now, because he's an unbeliever, he wants you to obey him and to disobey God, that's not the kind of submission the Lord is telling us. No, that's not the kind of submission. That's why it says, as it is fit, as it is in accordance to the word of God. If your husband wants to lead you to sin against God, he wants to lead you into error, you take your stand and say, no, that's not the kind of submission the Bible is telling me. As it is fit, the submission of the wife to the husband must be in accordance to the word of God, must be in accordance to the will of God, must be in accordance to the way of the Lord. Then it says in verse 19, husbands, love your wives. Husband, love your wife. Husband, love should be the very foundation of your relationship with your wife. And it says, as a result of your love for your wife, be not bitter. Be not bitter against them. There is nothing that will make you, nothing your wife will do against you that will make you to hate that woman. That's what the Bible is telling us today. That's why it says, love your wife, because love covers a multitude of sin. When you say the multitude of sin, he's talking about, maybe he's not just talking about the sin against God. Do you understand? He's talking about maybe the shortcomings of the wife. He's talking about the shortcoming of the woman. That then she's trying to prepare you a dinner, and that dinner gets bored. What do? Love. As a result of your love for the woman, you don't say, because of that, since you've decided to be giving me burnt food, I will not be eating food from you again. No, you don't do that. As a man, because your love should cover the mistakes, your love should cover the shortcomings of that woman. That's what the Bible is telling us there. Love. Then it says in verse 20, children, obey your parents in all things. When you talk about a divine impacted family. We are talking about a family where there is a wife and the husband, and then God blesses them. Maybe they have children. There are some that have children. That doesn't mean that's not a divine impacted family. But for such families that have a children or a child in that home, the responsibility of that child in that family is to obey your parents in all things. Why? Because this is well pleasing unto the Lord. The society may tell you that, oh, once you're a teenager, you're on your own. No, not at all. You still be your parents. The society may tell you, oh, once you are 18, or according to the lawyer, once you are 16, they already consider you that you are responsible on your own. You don't see the cause of that you disobey your parents. You don't see the cause of that you go against all the things your parents have taught you. You don't see the cause of that you go against the word of God. For those of us who are in the university, you don't see because I'm in the university now, and my parents are not here to have an oversight function over me. As a result of that, I can do whatever. No, not at all. For a divinely impacted family, the design of God, the roadmap of God for such family is that the children will be obedient to their parents in all things. In all things, in accordance to the word of God. Then he says, fathers, provoke not your children to anger. Provoke not your children. As a father in the family, in the home, don't provoke your children to anger. Those children in your family, those of offspring the Lord has given you the grace to raise up in that home, you don't provoke them by your attitude, by your overbearing attitude over there, that you want them what took you over 30 years to learn. You want those children, even in that age, that they want to learn all those things when they are 9, when they are 10, no, not at all. Provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. That's the roadmap the Lord is setting before us. And I pray that the Lord himself will give us the grace to be the doers of these things in Jesus' name. There are roles and responsibilities that the Lord demands from us as members of this divinely impacted family. And the Lord expects us to be faithful and to be committed in fulfilling our own role, in playing your own part. If you are here, you are not yet married, you know, you want to look at all these things. We are talking about the family today, but you want to raise up a family that is grounded and founded on the word of God. And I pray God will give you such family in Jesus' name. When we do all these things, you are playing your part, I'm playing my own part. The children are playing their part. There will be the fullness and the outpouring of God's blessings in our lives, in our families, in our neighborhoods, and also in our church, here in Jesus' name. As a result of that, our homes will be peaceful, our homes will be blissful, and it will be like we are told in Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 21, as the days of heaven upon the earth. This the Lord will do in our families in Jesus' name. That's why we are considering this message, the Vision 2020 roadmap for a divinely impacted family. For better understanding, we consider this message under three sub-headings. But when we look at the essence of pure law in a God-impacted family, the essence, the importance, the foundation. If that family is to be impacted by God, there must be this foundation, the fundamental of law in that family. You cannot just build a family without a foundation. No, look at the structure where we are now. There is a foundation that is pulling this structure together. It's another fruit. For those of us who are involved in building or you know about construction, you know, before you build anything, then you must lay a good foundation. If the foundation is faulty, that building will crumble. The same thing the Lord is telling us today, that pure law is important. Is fundamental if we must have a God-impacted family. For those of us who are not yet married, you want to ensure that this law, you have experienced this law, that this love is in you. If you must have this God-impacted family. And then point two, we look at the effective and potent lovers in a God-instructed family. Is a God in a God-instructed family, every member of such family have an active roles to play, responsibilities to keep. It's not just one is playing his role and another one is, you know, is just passing there and say, well, I'm just in this family, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. No, not at all. Husband, you have your own role to play. Wife, you have your own roles to play. Children, you have your own roles to play. We must be active. We must be effective and potent in playing our roles as lovers in this God-instructed family. Then point three, before we pray, we will do all these things, and when you play your part in that family and everyone playing their part in accordance to this roadmap that the Lord is giving to us today, there will be an enduring and perfection of life in a God-inspired family. Enduring and perfection, the fullness of blessing, the fullness of God, the perfection of life. It will be a little paradise. Your home will be a paradise you're now. And such homes the Lord will give to us in Jesus' name. Can I hear louder? Amen. Let's go straight to point one, the essence of pure law in a God-impacted family. You see that from our text again. Colossians chapter 3. I'll read from verse 12. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any man hath a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above all these things, you see the essence there. You see the importance of this pure love there. He says, above all these things, put on. What did the Bible say you should put on? Look at your Bible now. What did the Bible say you should put on? Put on what? Charity. Put it on. Put it on, my brother. Put it on, my sister. Put it on, children in the family. Put on charity, which is the bound of perfectness. Charity is a demand of God in the family. Love is the very foundation and the nature of God. That's why if you must have a divine impacted family, establish your heart, you need this pure law as a foundation. You need this law at the very beginning of your family. You need this law we are talking about because it is the nature of God. It is the requirement of God. It is law. It is law that will make all the individuals in that family, all the components in that family, to play their role. For the wife in verse 18, how will the wife be submissive to the husband when there is no law for the man? The wife can never be submissive. When the woman doesn't love the wife, the husband, she can never be submissive. How can the husband be not bitter against his own wife? if there is no law in the heart of that man? And how can the children in verse 20 obey their parents if they don't love their parents? That's why love is essential. Love is important in a God-impacted family. We are told in Leviticus chapter 19. Look at your Bibles. Leviticus chapter 19. And we, verse 18 of Leviticus 19, says, thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt do what? Thou shalt do what? Love thy neighbor as thyself. Love thy neighbor. Who is your nearest neighbor if you are married? I'm asking, who is your nearest neighbor? Your mother-in-law? Your father-in-law? I'm asking you, no, it's your spouse. It's your wife. It's your husband. That's your nearest neighbor. That's the closest neighbor to you. And the Bible says, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Husband, you love your wife like that? Do you love your wife the way you take care of yourself? Is that the same love, affection you show to the woman? Woman, do you love your own husband like that? The way you care for yourself? The way you show affection for yourself? Do you love your husband like that? He says, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. This love is important. If we must have a divine impacted family, the love of God must be in every member of the family. We must have experienced this love of God at salvation. If you have not experienced this love of God at salvation, the invitation is coming to you today. The Lord is calling you today. The Word of God is calling you today. If there is sin in your life, if there is evil in your life, you need to turn away from your sin. You need to turn away from your evil. Because the Bible says in John chapter 3 verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It is the love of God that made him to give his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross of Calvary. And Jesus died for you, my sinner friend, here today. Jesus died for you on the cross so that you can be saved, so that you will not perish, so that you may experience the love of God. That's why if you must have a God-impacted family, this love of God must be in your life. You must have experienced this love as salvation. The Bible says, if he that cometh his sin shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy, shall have forgiveness. There is forgiveness here for you today. That's the beginning of this love of God, this pure love of God we are talking about. We are not talking about the erotic love that is being practiced there out in the world. We are talking about the agape love, the pure love, the Christ-like love, the godly love, the love that will give eternal life, the love that will give you entrance into heaven, the love that will give you life here on earth and life hereafter. That's the love the Lord is calling us to. And this love is fundamental. And this love is essential if we must have a godly family. If we must have a family that is built on the word of God. We are told in Matthew chapter 22. The essence of pure love. In a God-impacted family. Matthew chapter 22 of Matthew. I'll read from verse 39. The Bible says, This is the voice of our Lord Jesus Christ now. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And these two commandments and all the law and the prophets. Thou shalt love the closest of you, like we say, is your wife, is your husband. And the Lord expects that we should love. And for us to love as God demands, we must be saved. Not only are we saved, we must also be sanctified. If you must have this love we are talking about, you must be sanctified. Your heart must be pure. Because you are told in Deuteronomy chapter 30. Deuteronomy chapter 30. Chapter 30 of Deuteronomy. I will read verse 6. Please open your Bibles with me. In verse 6, the Bible says here, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thy heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest live. That thou mayest live. The Lord will do this in our lives in Jesus' name. If we must love our neighbors ourselves, selfless love, sacrificial love, the love that is Christ-like, there must be this circumcision of heart, the removal of the Adamic nature, the crucifixion of the selfish nature in man. That's why it says, it is until the Lord circumcises your heart that you can love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. That's why the Lord is calling us today to this pure love, to this perfect love, because we are told in 1 Peter. Open your Bible with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. I'll read from verse 22 of 1 Peter chapter 1. The Bible says here, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart, with a pure heart, with a pure heart fervently. See that you love one another. Love your wife with a pure heart. Love your husband with a pure heart. That you are not planning anything evil against that man. That you are not planning anything evil against that woman. That you are not planning anything evil against your parents. That you are not planning anything evil against your children. That's the pure love the Lord is telling us here tonight. It's not an, you know, a love, a fake love. It says unfeigned love, unpretending love. It's not a pretentious love. There are some women, when their husbands are away, they will pretend as if they love their husband, they are missing the husband, but you know within your heart that you are so happy with yourself that the man is not in the house with you. But the man has gone to war. You are just so happy within yourself. Oh, thank God that man has gone with his trouble. And when he comes home, my husband, my husband, my husband, that's pretentious love. A man that went to work, and then you cannot speak with him, you cannot speak with her, and you say, well, you cannot even send a text message. When that woman is going to her work, you can't even say, oh, my wife, let me see you all. You can't even give her a kiss. I say, well, for me, let him just go with his trouble. And you say, well, I love you. That's pretentious love. That's not the unfeigned love. The love the Lord is telling you is a fervent love. That your heart is always longing after your husband. That your heart is always longing after your wife. That when that woman is not there with you, that when that man is not there with you, you know something is missing in your life. That's the word, that's the Lord is telling us which you are. Unfeigned love, fervent love. That you love one another fervently. unpretentious law, with a pure law. I pray the Lord will do this in our families in Jesus' name. Can I hear another amen? This law the Lord is calling us to, it should be an active law. It should be a law that is not passive. It should be a law that is not pretentious. It's not a law that is impure. Not evil. You are not planning evil. You are not looking for the downfall of that woman. You are not looking for the downfall of that man. You are not looking for the, you know, for the destruction of that woman. He is a pure of a Christ-like law. A law without any inferior motive. It's not a law you are looking for and say, well, if I love him now, what will I gain from him? It's not what you will gain, it's what you yourself will bring to the table. That's the kind of law the Lord is telling us to have. It's a law that you are playing your part to support your husband. That you are playing your part to support your wife, to achieve her highest potential, to achieve her potentials in life. That's the kind of law the Lord is calling us to. And this law is important. This law is the foundation, this pure law. Remember, this law, it must be the saving law. The law that has been saved, that has experienced salvation. Salvation from sin, salvation from evil, salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. This law, it is the sanctifying law. It is, number three, the selfless law. That you are not just thinking about yourself all the time. As the wife in that family, you are selfless. You are willing to make sure that that husband, that your own husband, have the best in life. That you are the husband, you are selfless. Not that you are selfish all the time. That you are willing. You say, oh, my wife, you know, you don't hide your accounts from your wife. That's the kind of selfless law we are talking about. You bring it to the table. You give the woman the access to everything about your life. That's the kind of selfless love we are talking about. That everything you do as the man in the family, you are doing everything for the sake of your wife. That's the selfless love we are talking about. That's the way Christ loved us. He gave himself. That's what the Bible says in Ephesians. Look at it. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5. The kind of love we are talking about. Ephesians chapter 5. I will read verse 25. Husbands, love your wives. Even as Christ also loved the church. And do what? What did the Bible say? Read your Bible with me. What did the Bible say Christ did? And gave himself for it. I'm asking you, what are you giving for your wife? As the husband, what are you giving? What are you giving? I don't know some husbands that are competing with their wives and say, oh, my wife must not beat me. What are you competing with that woman for? If she wants to go ahead of you, let her go. Let her go. Give your, Christ never competes with the church. Did Christ compete with the church? No, no, even told the church. He says, when I'm gone, greater works will you do. Is that not what he said? You don't compete with your wife. Don't turn your family to a battlefield. The husband, the wife, the wife is saying, oh, my husband, me too, I must do this, I must do that. You wait patiently. You don't compete with your husband. Give up yourself. Give. Christ gave himself. Christ gave himself. That man needs you. Give him yourself. Give him yourself. That woman needs you. Give him yourself. That's what the Lord is saying here. As Christ gave himself for the church. This love must be sacrificial. This pure law we are talking about, it must be a sacrificial law. It's number five, it must be a serving law. You are serving one another. Husband serving the wife also serving the other. It's not all the time the wife will be serving the husband. It's not all the time it's the wife that is always making food for the husband. No, not at all. Nothing stops you as the man and say, oh, my wife, today, don't worry about the dinner. I'll take care of the dinner. I'll prepare the dinner for you. The woman is tired. She's dying. Have you not seen people going to make tea for their own wife and bringing it to the bedroom and show my wife, stay on bed. I'll bring the breakfast here. That's the kind of love we're talking about, the serving love. When last did you serve your own wife? When last? As the man. Or you don't sit down there, the woman is prepared, and it is a woman, she has gone for, 8 hours shift, 12 hours shift, she's so knackered, she's so tired, and yet, you as the man, you still expect that woman to prepare the dinner for you, to spend hours preparing that dinner, and bringing that dinner to the table, and you are not there to say, my wife, what do you want me to do? My wife, what do you want me to support you with? Because women, they love their kitchen. But you can go in and say, my wife, please, you just came back from a 12-hour shift. My wife, you just came back from an 8-hour walk. Take time off. What do you want me to do? Give me what to do for you. I will do it for you. You do it, like some of us, some people are not good in cooking. They can decide to burn the soup. Yes, you burn it once, but you will not do it the second time. Give that man the opportunity to help you. Give yourself for one another. Let's serve one another. Parents, are you serving your children? You just expect to say, my children now, let them continue to serve me. There are times, parents too, we are supposed to serve our children. We don't take things for granted. That's what the Lord is telling us here. That's the kind of law. Number 6 is a submissive law. Submissive. The wife submitting to the husband. Submissive. Calling him, like we are told, Sarah called Abraham Lord. Why? You should respect to your husband. The age of today, they are telling us now family is 50-50. It's not 50-50 in accordance to the word of God. In accordance to the word of God, family, godly family is 100% from the wife, 100% from the husband. It's 100-100. And 100-100 is an excellent family. Amen? And that will be your own family. Why submit yourself to your own husband? You may hate more than the man, submit yourself to him. You may be educated more than the wife, more than your husband, submit yourself to him. You don't say, my wife, my husband, what does he have? Who is he? Look at me, I'm known all over the world, I have prestige all over the world, I have honor all over the world, and that man is nowhere. No, you still submit yourself to your own husband. You may have money more than the man. You may earn more than your husband. But you don't say because you are earning so much and then you are hiding it from the man, and the man doesn't know you are building a mansion back in Africa where you came from. You are building, you are sending money to your people and the man is not aware of it. You have another account that you are hiding away from the man. The man is not aware of it. The Bible says, submit yourself to your own husband. And husband, can I tell you too? Submit yourself to your wife. Not just the wife submitting to you. You also, it is love. When you love your own wife, you will submit yourself to him, to her. You will submit yourself to her, your account, your details. You will not hide anything. I don't know some men today, when the wife takes their phone and she cannot even access the phone of her own husband. What a lie. Give your wife the password. Give her the pin to your phone. What are you hiding in your phone? What text message are you hiding from your wife? What emails are you hiding from your wife? The Lord says submit. Submit yourself one to another. Don't do anything behind that woman. Let the woman know everybody you are dealing with. Everybody that calls you. Every lady that works with you in the office. Introduce your wife to them. Introduce your husband to them. Don't be ashamed of your husband. Don't be ashamed of your wife. Take her with you. There are some people, they say they are married. And they have social platform everywhere. And yet, you don't know their wives. And yet, you don't even know their husband. You don't know who they are married. They are ashamed of their wife. the shame of your husband. Submit yourself. Be proud of your own mother. Because that man, you have married him, and that is sanctioned forever. Until death do you apart. Do you know that that's the standard of the word of God? That what God has joined together, let no man do what? Put asunder. In Christian marriage, God doesn't permit remarriage and the divorce is against the will of God. The Bible says God hates putting away. He hates putting away in Malachi chapter 3. And number 7 should be a securing law. When we do all these things, then when our homes are built on this foundation, this fundamental principle of law, then the Lord expects that we play a part in the family. This leads us to point 2, effective and potent lovers in a God-instructed family. I've said some of this already, so I'll just quickly run through this. In Colossians, if you go back to our text again, Colossians chapter 3, what's our responsibilities? For the wife, he says in verse 18, wives, submit yourself unto your own husband, as it is fit in the Lord. Submit yourself to your own husband. Wives are expected to submit themselves, herself, to her own husband. As the woman in the family, the Lord expects that you submit. That you submit yourself. There are times it may not be convenient for you, but for the sake of the word of God, you submit yourself to that man. There are times you might be weak, and if you're a man, you must understand the weakness of your woman. Even though she's giving you herself, but you still need to understand her body comportment, her weaknesses. Yet, as the woman, you don't say, because I'm weak, because I'm dying, then you are hiding yourself away from the man. Submit yourself to your own husband. Don't hide yourself from him. Don't hide yourself from your husband. Make your bedroom a separate place. A place where you submit yourself to your own husband. You know, it's not coming to church and submitting to the leadership that is important before God. What God counts important for you is your submission to your own husband. You don't hide yourself away from that man. Not only that, as a woman, the Lord expects that as Christ is, as the church is subject unto Christ. In Ephesians chapter 4, look at the role of the wife. In Ephesians chapter 4, I'll read verse 24 of Ephesians chapter 4. The Bible says here that, let me just read from verse 22, wives, submit yourself unto your own husbands as unto the Lord, as you submit yourself unto the Lord. And say, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. So you give your body. You see, my husband, at that altar of marriage, I give my body unto you, consecrated unto you. And you don't allow anyone to tamper with that body except your own husband. No one should tamper with your body as a wife in that family. No one has the right to touch any sensitive part of your body except your own husband. That's what the Lord is telling us here. Submit yourself to your own husband as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. In everything. In everything. Be subject to your own husband in everything. In your professional career, in your secular job, be subject. Be subject. to do anything without the permission of your own husband. Don't do anything without discussing with the man first. Don't just think, oh, well, for me, I have my own life to live. The man also has his own life to live. I can do whatever I want to do in that family. No, not at all. No, that's not what the Lord has called us into. The Lord says, you are subject. Everything you do, you must bring it to the table of the man and get his approval before you do it. Get his understanding, get his buying into that thing before you do it. That's what the Lord is telling us here. Then for the husband, these are the ways we can show our effectiveness as lovers in the family. If you go back to Colossians chapter 3, and the wife, for the wife, when you do all these things, you must be meek, modest, mild, moderate, mellow, meditative, merry, and also mature in every matter. Why the husband, your love for the wife, for your own wife, in the Lord expects in Colossians chapter 3, verse 19, husband, love your wife and be not bitter against them. This love we are talking about for the husband must be the love that is compassionate, must be the love that is considerate. You are considerate of the woman's weaknesses at times. You don't override that woman. You know, there are some people that will just, you know, turn their wife to a child product, you know, a child manufacturing company. You don't do that. You want to understand the nature of your own wife. And you agree with her, and you support her. This love we are talking about must be Christ-like, sacrificial, like we said also. It must be a conscious love. You are doing this deliberately to show your love for your own wife. You are doing it, and you don't just love the woman and say, oh, I'm not loving you unconsciously. You are doing it deliberately. Take a deliberate act. What do I mean by that? You can decide today and say, my wife, today, you are not going to prepare the dinner. Today, we are all going to eat out. I'm taking you out. That's the conscious law. Because you understand the situation of that woman. You know, what do you mean by that? You can do it and say, oh, deliberately. You say, oh, my wife, you know, there are some men that don't even know the size of their wife. And what is she? You don't know the sizes of your wife. You don't even know the size of her shoe. The size of her dress. What is she? Why don't you just ask the woman? Why don't you just secretly, while she's sleeping, take her clothes, that her favorite clothes, and look at the number there, look at the sizes there. Don't tell her. This is the conscious love we are talking about. You go online, you go to all those shopping places, and deliberately do the shopping for your wife. That's the conscious love we are talking about. It's not just I say, I love you. What are you doing to express your love for your wife? It should be an active thing. Husband, love your own wife. Is it? It's a conscious love. A conscious law. You respect that woman. You honor that you are. It's a considerate law. It's a comprehensive law. It's a comprehensive law. It's not just law that is spiritual only. It affects every other area of that woman's life. You show that law comprehensively to your own wife. It's a law that is committed, with commitment. A committed law that you are putting commitment to that law to make your love better. You want to ask yourself, in this 2020, how can I love my wife the more? That's the commitment the Lord is telling us tonight. And I pray God will give us the grace to be the doers of all these things in Jesus' name. As children in the family, he says, children, obey your parents in all things. For this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Children, obey. Your parents may not have no understanding like you are. They may not even have the knowledge of your own generation. But when they tell you that in accordance to the word of God, this is what I want you to do, you obey. You don't kick against it. You know, your parents may not be here, You may be in the UK and your parents are not here. You say, well, for me, I can just live my life anyhow. No, you still obey your parents in all things when they are checking on you. You don't deceive them. You don't lie to them. If you love your parents, you will not lie to them. If you love your parents, you will not do anything that will bring the name of your family into disrepute. I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. When we do all these things, lastly, we go to point three quickly before we pray. The enduring and perfection of life in a God-inspired family. In a God-inspired family. Let us quickly go through that passage again and see the perfection of life here. It says here in 18, wives, submit yourself unto your own husband as it is fit in the Lord. That's the perfection of life here, as it is fit in the Lord. In verse 19, husband, love your wives and be not bitter against them. That's the perfection of life, that be not bitter. Don't embitter your wife. Don't turn your family into a barrack, into a military zone, into a war zone, that every week, no expression of love, no life in that family, always fighting, always quarreling, no time you even laugh together, no time you even ask for. Look at Isaac. Isaac sported with his own wife. When last do you sport with your own wife? When last? We'll talk about, you play with her. When last do you, let there be an atmosphere of love in your family. Play with your wife. Just with your, be merry mate with your wife. Laugh with her. Not every time you always frown in the face. Not every time you always say, oh, this, holiness unto the Lord and holiness forever. My brother, holiness is not by frowning face. You don't get holiness by frowning face. Do you know that? You get holiness by the sacrificial work of Christ on the cross of Calvary. It is not by frowning face that we are made holy. It is by consecrating our life on the altar and asking the Lord to sanctify us that we are made holy. It is not by being bitter, by turning your house into a war zone, that you perfect holiness in your family. Let me tell you something. You know, sporting with your wife does not spoil your holiness. Do you know that? It doesn't spoil you. Look at Isaac, sporting with his wife. And yet, he still had the everlasting covenant. Sporting with your wife, sporting with your husband. My sister, release yourself. It's not every time you say, oh, this is, my husband, I'm a prayerful woman. I pray 24/7. And every time, tying it. Every time, the scarf, bandage, scarf, everything must be, even when going to bed. Everything, because you don't know when the demon will come and then you start praying. It's not like that. It's not like that. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Make care for your, why most women cover their head? Because they don't make their head. Do you know that? But when you make your head beautiful in a godly way, not with all the excesses that people are now putting on the head now, no, but in that godly way, your husband will like it, your husband will love it, your husband will cherish your hair, and he will be playing with your hair. That's the law we are talking about here. There are some husbands that even make the hair for their wife. Nothing stops you from doing that for your own wife. That's the love we are talking about. Sporting, that's the perfection of life. Let there be love in our family. Let there be life. Don't turn your family into a war zone. Let everyone be free. Let the wife be free to achieve her potential. Let the husband be free to achieve his own potential. Let the children, give them their freedom. No, that's what we are learning today. Because the Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, God saw everything that he has made. And they were what? And they were good. Everything in your family will be good in Jesus' name. It is love that brings perfection that brings love, that brings happiness, that brings fruitfulness, that brings productivity, that brings happiness in the home. And when this love is there, I'm telling us tonight, great things the Lord will do in our families in Jesus' name. Because we are told in Psalm 127. Quickly before we pray, Psalm 127, I'll read from verse 3 to 5. Psalm 127, Lord, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. In your family today, there are no children, the children are coming. Can I hear that? Amen. The children are coming in Jesus' name. This year, the Lord will surprise you. As you follow through this roadmap, the Lord has given to his church today, children will be an heritage in your home in Jesus' name. As arrows in the hands of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Your children will be arrows in your hand. With your own children, you will conquer this land. Your children will conquer this land. Happy is the man that has made his children full of them. They shall not be ashamed. You will not be ashamed. This year, you will not be ashamed. In your family, you will not be ashamed. But they shall speak with the enemies in the great things the Lord will do for us in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 8, the fullness, the perfection of life. In a God-inspired family. Blessing the promise of God there for family. Isaiah chapter 8, I'll read verse 18 of Isaiah chapter 8. It says there in verse 18, it says, behold, I and the children whom the Lord has given unto me are for what? Are for what? Signs and wonders. Your children will be for signs and wonders. In this land of Aberdeen, in this country of the United Kingdom, your children will be for signs and wonders in Jesus' name. As we follow this word now, as we begin to play our own part and ensure that we are building our home on godly principles, great will be the things the Lord will do for us in Jesus' name. We will serve the Lord together. With our families, we will serve the Lord. With our children, we will serve the Lord. With our spouses, we will serve the Lord. There might be challenges at times. There might be problems at times. There might be troubles at times. But through it all, the Lord will give you the victory in Jesus' name. As you make up your mind that you want to play your own part, you want to fulfill your own role in that family, you are demonstrating what the Lord expects you to do, and you are living in accordance to the word of God, bringing Christ as the head of that family. At the head, the husband, you are making a direction. You are directing the family in the path that they should go. Great will be the things the Lord will do for our families in Jesus' name. Your children will be for signs and wonders. Your husbands will be for signs and wonders. Your wives will be for signs and wonders. And through it all, we will conquer the land in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and begin to commit all these things we've learned to the Lord in prayers today. The Lord demands that there should be love in our families. Let your home be a home of love, a home of peace, a home of respect and honor, where you honor one another, where you obey one another, where you show affection for one another. Let there be love. Where there is no love in your home, let there be a restoration of that love. Let's talk to the Lord. Let's commit ourselves to the hands of the Lord tonight. If you are here, you are say, there must be the foundation of this love in your family. Let's commit ourselves to the hands of the Lord and tell the Lord and say, Lord, do it in my life. Do it in my home. Do it in my family. And great things the Lord will do for you. Let's talk to the Lord. Let's talk to the Lord tonight. That the Lord will do it. Love your wife. Love your husband. Let's pray that the Lord will give us the grace that will be the doers of this thing. We will show affection for one another. We show respect for one another. You will care for that woman. You won't care for that one. Let's commit ourselves to the hands of the Lord tonight. That the Lord Himself will help us. This roadmap the Lord has given to us, the Vision 2020 roadmap for a divinely imparted family. Let's pray that the Lord will help us. We play our own part. You want to play your own part. You will fulfill your own role. And great things the Lord will do in your own family. Great things the Lord will do in your own family. Let's talk to the Lord. Let's ask for the grace of God. You are not yet born again. Pray. Repent of your sin. Let Jesus come into your heart. You are saved. You are not yet sanctified. Talk to the Lord tonight. Let the Lord sanctify you. Let the Lord sanctify you. Let's pray that the Lord Himself will give us that grace. We will love our lives. We will love our children. Children will be obedient to our parents. You will not be a wayward children. You will not be one of those children out there in the street. No respect for their families. No respect for their parents. Let's talk to the Lord that the Lord will help us. Even though your parents will not be here, yet you will still respect them. The parents that the Lord has given to us in the church, we will respect them. Our leaders will be respected. We will show respect to all our children. Let's pray that the Lord Himself will help us. Now all these things we've learned today, we not just hear them, but we'll be the doers of them. Let's ask for the Lord that our families will be like heaven on earth. Pastor Sherman.
Jesus' name we pray. Our Most High God, bless your name for your mercy and for your grace. We give you glory for giving us privileges to be in a family. We give you glory for giving us the grace to have been a product of the family. And we give you honor because we know for everyone here that is married, you're going to bless that union mightily in Jesus' name. Amen. And for those who are single, spinsters, bachelors, we pray that God, you do great things in their lives. And Lord, you unite them according to your purpose, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen. God, the strength we need, the grace we need, the power we need, the love we need, O Lord, to give ourselves to you. Give unto us, O Lord, in Jesus' name. The Bible says, it's not by might, it's not by power. By what? By your spirit. We pray that God, your spirit will walk in us out your will in Jesus' name. That God will come close to you in prayer, will come close to you in reading your word. And as we experience your love, we'll redeem that love to those who are around us in Jesus' name. That as we go home, our spouse will see your love, will see your love in us worked out in Jesus' name. That we will leave the realm of theology. Who will lead the era of theory and will go into the hands of practical area in Jesus' name. That not just in our word, but in our action, we will love our spouses, we will love our children, we will love our friends, we will love those around us, O Lord, in Jesus' name. And Lord, every cancer of the devil against our homes, against our families, against our future, O Lord, we come against, O God, in the name of Jesus. That whenever fears come, faith and love will be the door to open that door and to repent to God in Jesus' name. Father, we bless you for all you've done for us, O Lord. Pray for our pastor. I pray, God, your grace, your mercy, your anointing will abound in his life in Jesus' name. Lord, thank you. We restore to him, O God, and his household mightily in Jesus' name. We give you praise for all you've done. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. We get seated, please. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Love will be in our home. Love will be in our families in Jesus' name. And for